Working 500 feet below the North Sea requires a gambler's instincts. But when Richard Walker and Vic Giehl died, were the odds unfairly stacked against them? And if so, why? A report by Brian Gould.
I just couldn't understand that Richard was fated to die at that time. His life was not ready to end. It was almost as if they had the wrong man. And I remember telling someone, I was sure they had made a mistake, that it was someone else in the bell.
In the North Sea, oil means money, but it also means danger. The rewards have been enormous for the country, the oil companies, and individuals. But the sea has exacted a price for yielding up its riches. A price sometimes paid in men's lives. Men like Vic Giehl, 30-year-old American deep-sea diver, and his compatriot Richard Walker, who both died in the North Sea on the 8th of August, 1979.
He's blown the whole house away and the mouth.
2 years later, Richard Walker's widow, Jeannie, has still received no compensation.
Who's this? That's a pretty girl hippopotamus.
At the time he died, she'd been left behind in California to look after their baby daughter. Marissa was then just 15 months old.
He was very fond of Marissa. She was sort of the light of his life. He was surprised that he felt that way because I guess he hadn't seen himself as a family man until the time he met me. I think he shielded me from a lot of his feelings about his work because he didn't want me to believe it was dangerous. He didn't want me to worry. I know he enjoyed diving, but whether he enjoyed saturation diving, I don't know.
Saturation divers work far out in the North Sea. They're offshore for weeks at a time. These are the men who actually work on the seabed. On duty, they can spend up to 5 weeks at pressures artificially created to match what they'll find hundreds of feet down. They spend up to half their time working. For the rest, there's nothing much to do but eat, read, and sleep. In these cramped quarters on deck, there's both a physical and psychological strain. So every week spent in saturation earns them a week off work on shore. The pay is high too, up to £500 a week, but the earning life of a diver is a short one. Most get out in their early 30s. In saturation, the air they breathe is a mixture of 2% oxygen and 98% helium. The gas saturates the body tissue, and at the end of a diving trip, it will take 5 days in saturation to bring their bodies back to normal. The helium has one other effect. It distorts the divers' voices. Their colleagues on deck control everything. The pressure, temperature, and air supply inside the chamber and the diving bell.
Riser, and you'll be taking off an old riser clamp, and then we'll be putting on the new clamp.
When their shift begins, the bell is locked on to the saturation chamber for the divers to enter. Inside, they put on their suits, which, like the bell itself, are heated by hot water. The bell, lowered on the main lift cable, is guided down on wires attached to a large piece of metal called the clump weight, another of whose functions is to hold the bell a few feet off the seabed. The hot water, air, power, and communications are all supplied to the bell through a collection of tubes, the bell's umbilical. The main hazard of the North Sea is the cold. Even a brief interruption in the supply of hot water would be fatal. The divers take it in turns to work outside. Even this cramped bell will seem a welcome haven after 4 hours of exhausting work. 500 feet down, visibility almost nil, they lose their sense of color and half their sense of touch. Richard Walker's feelings about this cold, lonely, and claustrophobic world are revealed in the diary he always kept.
They did diving work around the clock, regardless of whether it was light or dark. And the 7th of August, he wrote that he was on location at Thistle Field. The boat heaves a lot. Roger, that was one of the other men in saturation, says there are conger eels all over. We'll find out today. Poor topside management. I know that the only reason why he was still there was because of us, and that's hard to live with. He says, I miss my little one. It really carves a hole right out of me. He says, I don't even know if I'm going to get out alive.
The diving support vessel, the Wildrake, was in the first week of its work for the British National Oil Corporation in the Thistle Field. On board was Brian Masterson, boss of Infadco, the diving contractors. The deck foreman on the day shift was Dave Lane. John Brooke replaced him at midnight. All three were to be caught up in the 17-hour rescue attempt. At 11 p.m., the Wildrake sent two of its divers, Richard Walker and Vic Giel, down to check repairs previously done to an underwater installation. The bell would normally have been lowered on guide wires with the clump weight. But so that the bell could go over the side, instead of through the moon pool in the bottom of the ship, these were removed. In the early hours, Richard Walker, working outside the bell, saw it had slipped. He was instructed to return immediately. The main lift wire had broken away. A crucial pin had fallen out. The BNOC representative on board the Wildrake kept a diving log. It records the accident, and he notes the time, 2:45 a.m.
Marissa and I were leaving to go shopping one day and came out of the house. I was helping her down the steps. She was just walking, but not very confidently. And a man drove up who I knew, worked for the company. He came up to me and said, there's been an accident. Said not to worry, that Richard was fine, and it would just be a matter of time before they raised the bell to the surface, because what had happened was the cable had snapped, I believe he said. And they hadn't struck the bottom hard. They were working close to the bottom, so not to worry. It was just a matter of time.
There was no immediate problem. Hot water, air, and communications were still being supplied through the umbilical. But it hadn't been approved as a means of lifting the bell, so the attempt then made to do so turned a difficulty into a crisis.
Once the weight had been transferred totally to the umbilical, it was found that the umbilical tended to flatten out because it was not braided in any way. It was just loomed together and taped at, I think, approximately sort of 18-inch, 2-foot intervals. And as we attempted to lift the bell with the umbilical, the bell, A, jammed down the side of the two plates on the side, and it was fairly obvious that it was stretching, and there was no way the bell was going to be lifted with this particular method.
So they then tried to bypass the winch and use the ship's crane to lift the bell on the umbilical. Did that work?
No, it didn't, because, again, because of this lack of strength in the umbilical, when the strength was taken over this knot, the knot just literally chewed into the umbilical and was obviously doing far more damage than had been done previously.
One by one, the bell's life support systems were ruptured. At that point, the bell was lowered, or fell, no one is sure which, to the seabed. What little was left of the umbilical was eventually cut to avoid obstructing other efforts to raise the bell.
Do you think when the bell fell back at that point, was that a crucial moment in the rescue attempt?
I believe so. I believe it. I believe for the two men inside, that was probably the last they knew of what was happening.
They still had no news. And I could see that he was beginning to be very concerned. And I said, but why are you worried? Because if you've just dropped it, what could be wrong with them? They still have their hot water, they have their air. And he said, no, they don't. That they had cut those lines. They had broken. And then he said it was just a matter of time, that we just had to hope.
Even with the main lift wire gone and hot water and air supplies cut off, there was still a third emergency lifting system. The divers themselves could release drop weights, which would allow the bell to rise through its own buoyancy. But the drop weights had been tied on from the outside, and this, coupled with the removal of the clump weight, left the divers caught in a cruel trap.
It was standard procedure with companies to actually lash off as a secondary safety measure, to actually lash the drop weights onto the bell. So they had a quick release system inside, but to make sure that this quick release system did not operate without the intention of the divers inside, a diver had to go out initially to cut off the nylon lashings. But of course, that's all well and good if the diver can actually get outside, but I believe in this situation it was fairly impossible for the diver to find room between the seabed and the base of the trunking.
The bell ordinarily would have sat on top of the clump weight, allowing the divers to get in and out in the event that they should lose their main lift. In this case, it meant that the bell sat on the seabed and the bottom of the bell door was flush with the seabed itself, and they couldn't get out to release their own drop weights or to effect a wet transfer to another bell.
Shortly after 3 a.m., the Stena Welder, another vessel working for BNOC nearby, was called in to help, since the Wildrake couldn't lift the bell unaided. Alan Mellor was the captain. For 17 hours, he kept his ship above the Wildrake bell, a feat of seamanship praised at the subsequent inquiry. It was 6 a.m. before the Stena Welder was ready to dive. It took their divers 2 more hours to locate the bell, because its homing device had been removed just before the fateful dive. The bell located, the Wildrake lowered its crane wire. The Stena Welder divers struggled for a further 2 hours to attach the wire to the bell. The Stena Welder wanted to lift the bell themselves, since they were directly above it, but they weren't permitted to do so. What no one knew was that the bell had become caught on the underwater structure. Captain Alan Mellor recalls what happened.
Well, it was a total farce. It was a total farce. It assumed an angle of 45 degrees, which we saw. I mean, I was on the bridge wing on the control of the ship. We saw the crane wire being taken up, assume an angle of 45 degrees. I pointed out to the BNOC representative on board our ship, who was doing the bridge liaison, that there is no way they could do a safe lift at 45 degrees. The BNOC representative passed my request across to Mr. Masterson, and his answer to that was, heave on everything, heave on everything. Well, needless to say, the burr ends come up.
So the fourth rescue attempt had failed. 9 agonizing hours elapsed before the Stena Welder divers could reconnect the crane wire to the bell. It was brought to the surface at 7:45 p.m.
Then they called again and said the bell was coming on board, and they would call us right back with the condition of my husband. It must have been an hour and a half before they called us back. And I heard what he said, and I heard what he asked, and I knew what they told him. But I still ask him when he came out, he's okay. That, no. He said he was dead. And all I remember was screaming and the walls falling in.
How did the people involved in the rescue attempt feel at that moment?
Sick. I felt very, very sick. I felt very bitter. I felt very bitter. Because I felt very, very strongly, and I felt more strongly afterwards, obviously, that if we'd have been allowed to do what we wanted to do, them two men would have been alive today.
When they eventually got the bell up, did you personally have any hopes at that stage?
Not really. I don't think any of us really did. And when we finally got the bell on deck, we lifted it out of the water. One of the men was actually lying inside one of the large portholes, and it was a pretty horrific sight. And we all felt pretty sick. We all realized there was no chance.
It would have made life a lot easier if we'd have been allowed to do what we wanted to do. And that, as I said, was to attach a line to the top of the stricken bell and then run a davit line down it, and then we could lift the bell. Then we would have had the bell. We weren't allowed to do this.
But your theory was never been put to the test. How do you know it would have worked?
It's worked since. I mean, since this particular incident, there's been a couple more incidents in the North Sea where they've done similar things, where they've lifted the bell and done a wet transfer.
The accident shocked and saddened Aberdeen, and especially the dead diver's friends, many of them friends of Jeannie as well.
I began to ask questions about who decided what, who did what, who was responsible for doing various things.
The man in charge of the rescue, an engineer rather than seaman or diver, was Brian Masterson, boss of Infabco Diving Services. 16 months later, it was his company that faced criminal charges for serious breaches of the diving regulations. Failure to obtain the necessary approvals for saturation diving, failure to ensure that the diving equipment was in safe and proper order. All the evidence on these points was presented at the four-day trial, but the key to its outcome lay here in Jersey. Brian Masterson had set up a company called Offshore Coordinators, a straightforward tax avoidance device. It enabled Infabco to plead that they were technically not the employers of the divers. The loophole has since been plugged, but it allowed Brian Masterson to walk out of court, his company acquitted. The company, and particularly Brian Masterson, didn't escape so lightly at the fatal accident inquiry held in Aberdeen. The sheriff's task was to report on the causes of the accident rather than attribute blame. But in his judgment published last month, the sheriff found that
rescue equipment wasn't properly tested. Diving equipment was faulty. Masterson made errors of judgment. His evidence in some respects was so obviously false that if a fatal accident inquiry were not a serious process, it would have been laughable.
Jeannie Walker recognized that the sheriff's strictures hurt Brian Masterson's reputation, but not much else. She was determined to raise that with Aberdeen's Procurator Fiscal.
I have first a couple of questions about the findings. I understand that the sheriff found that Brian Masterson was not telling the truth.
Yes, he made a comment to that effect, that, what does he say, if it hadn't been such a serious matter, his evidence would be laughable.
Okay, yes. Now, I don't know what the Scottish laws are about this, but I was hoping that this would enable you to bring perjury charges against Mr. Masterson, maybe on the basis of this evidence and maybe on the basis of similar evidence that he gave at the criminal trial.
Well, we'll have to consider that now, re-examine the evidence once again and see whether criminal proceedings are warranted.
The fiscal has confirmed to us that no further proceedings are contemplated. That's a decision that Jeannie will find disappointing.
Yes, but surely they were working for someone. I have my personal opinion about who they were working for, which I think is soundly based, but my interest is in seeing that these people be brought to trial.
So a clear disregard of safety standards has so far gone unpunished. The overall responsibility for North Sea oil safety rests with the Department of Energy. They've brought in new safety regulations to plug the gaps revealed by the Infabco accident. But it's the oil companies who actually extract the oil and who are responsible for operational safety. In this case, the operators were BNOC. We asked BNOC if, since the accident, they'd done anything to improve supervision of their contractors' safety standards, but they wished to make no comment. The safety buck stops with small firms like Infabco. Their lucrative contracts to run day-to-day operations mean intense competition. Corners may be cut. The sheriff, in his report following the fatal accident inquiry, said,
"The diving contractors were more concerned with speed than with safety.
And in particular,
the diving operations were commenced without first having established that the means of recovery would be effective. The decision to carry on diving without the clump weight was a serious error which made a material contribution to the deaths."
Brian Masterson was certainly a young man in a hurry. He'd done work for BNOC as an engineer. Linking up with Infabco Diving Services in 1978, he launched the new company into the big league with a major BNOC contract.
That was a contract to set up a diving system on the Gulnare. Like this, a semi-submersible reef. The contract proved to be so lucrative that it was described by a then director of Infabco as a once-in-a-lifetime deal. At the time they made their bid, the new company had an expert team of divers, highly regarded by Joe Singletary, then the BNOC offshore construction manager. But Infabco had something else going for them as well. In Joe Singletary's offices in Aberdeen for a pre-bid meeting over the weekend, they found out the details of rival bids. After submitting the lowest bid, they were awarded the contract on the following day. We telephoned Joe Singletary, who has since left BNOC, in Curaçao, to ask him about these matters.
In London.
Yes, go ahead, Brian.
Do you remember in June 1978, when Infabco Diving Services was trying to get its first contract, and indeed obtained a contract on the Gulnare, can you remember the circumstances of that contract being obtained?
Yeah, of course I remembered. It was investigated about three different times by the police over there, so it's all just a matter of record.
That's right, and also investigated by BNOC, I believe.
Yes, that's correct.
We invited him to recall the meeting at which we believe bid details were seen by Infabco.
It was a meeting at which was attended by four people at least from Infabco. I can name them for you if you wish. And the telex...
Talking about a bunch of crap like that has been fought over, it's been investigated by the police, all a matter of record. And you start trying to ask me if I remember something in the middle of this, and I don't even know what you're talking about. You know, it's a waste of time.
The second step in Infabco's success story was another important BNOC contract, this time with the Wildrake, the vessel involved in the fatal dive. In the spring of 1979, the Wildrake was being built and fitted out here in Stavanger. A number of diving firms expressed interest in the new ship, with a view to a forthcoming contract to repair an underwater installation for BNOC. But by the end of May, the Norwegian owners had reached agreement on the Wildrake's first charter with a new hirer, Infabco Diving Services. The negotiations were carried out in Stavanger by Bob Lloyd, then the Infabco general manager.
I believe we have an exclusive right to the Wildrake.
A legally binding right. No other sort would be much use to you.
An agreement is what I said, and that's what I believed, that we had an agreement. Whether that was in the form at that time of the charter party, or whether it was in the form of an agreement between the two parties, I don't know.
Were you the only company that had the Wildrake?
I don't know. I would hope so, because we thought we had an exclusive right, as you've previously said.
That exclusive right turned out to be a trump card when a BNOC telex inviting tenders for the new contract was issued on the 1st of June. The vessel which most closely matched the specifications was the Wildrake, though Joe Singletary says that several ships could have undertaken the work. However, it was clear that a firm offering the Wildrake had the best chance, and Infabco had obtained their exclusive right to the vessel a week before the BNOC telex was issued. At the time of the accident, Infabco was trying to win a third important BNOC contract.
Well, it was the daily conversation on board the vessel. You know, had anybody heard any news about the contract being renewed? Everybody was very concerned because obviously it meant employment for some time to come for quite a number of people.
As it was, the accident almost certainly cost Brian Masterson the contract. But that isn't the end of the story for Jeannie Walker.
That's it.
2.5 years after her husband's death, she hasn't received a penny in compensation. That's something she wanted to discuss with her Aberdeen solicitor, Reg Christie.
What have we got here?
You have brought an action in America. I'm not sure what stage that action's at now.
Well, we attempted to bring an action, but the Infabco failed to come to court, and we got default judgment.
Yes.
But Infabco have no American assets, and since Jeannie doesn't qualify for British legal aid, it would cost her thousands of pounds she doesn't have to pursue her claim here. We thought this should be raised with Brian Masterson personally.
Good morning, Mr. Masterson. Brian Gould's my name, from Thames Television. I wondered if you could tell me how you're getting on with your compensation claim. Do you mind?
I'd mind very much.
Yes, by all means.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes, but would you not please tell us how you're getting on with the claim by the widow?
Excuse me, I'll just take one time.
Certainly, yes. Will you speak to us after that?
No.
The Aberdeen oil industry, and particularly the diving contractors, tend to close ranks when things go wrong. They're sensitive about the industry's reputation, and people who talk out of turn aren't looked on with favor. That hasn't made Jeannie Walker's task any easier.
I seriously question at this point whether I will ever really know what happened to my husband or why. A few people have been very helpful and very kind. Many people have been very kind, but very much afraid.
For Jeannie, the truth about Richard's death may be all she can now hope to salvage.
It looks like the waves at home, doesn't it? Except it's cold.